and welcome to Watch It Played. My name is Rodney Smith, and in this video, we're going to learn the 3-7 player game, Forgotten Waters, which also includes rules for solo and two-player games. This was designed by Isaac Vega, J. Arthur Ellis, and Mr. Bistro, and published by Plat Hat Games, who helped sponsor this video. Imagine the foam of the ocean waters breaking against the hull of your vessel. The captain calling out frantic orders, and the enemy ship turning its broadside cannons towards you. So goes the life of a pirate, and each of you will be working together to survive on the open seas while also trying to fulfill your own unique destinies. Will you reach your goals or be buried in Davy Jones's locker? Well, there's only one way to find out. Join me at the table and let's learn how to play. To set up, place the map board and location book in the center of the play area. Then open the game's app by going to fwcrossroads.com. This is just a website, so you can run it from any device that will open a website and even install it for offline use, depending on the device that you're using. If run from the internet, this provides full audio and voice narrations, which I'll turn off for the sake of this video, but I do recommend it. Also keep in mind the publisher may make changes to the app over time, so what you're seeing might be a little different than what I show here, but you should have no trouble following along. With that in mind, tap Play Now to get started. 5 scenarios are included in the game, and all of these are replayable, but for your first game, they suggest picking Beyond the Ocean's Edge. From this screen, we'll then pick View Setup. Then it asks whether or not you want the scenario narrated with text or audio or both. We'll say both, but I have the audio turned off. Now it wants to know if this is our first time playing this scenario, and we'll say yes. And here it tells us how to set up the board, so that's what we'll do next. These are the double-sided special location tokens, and you'll need to find the ones that match the image shown within the app, and then place them on the board in the same way. It will look like this when you're done, and the app also tells us to place the pirate ship standee onto the space here. The tiles with this back are the navigation tokens, which you'll shuffle and place face down nearby, along with the reroll, misfortune, lock, and constellation tokens, which I've placed into trays I have that you can pick up from the link in the description. The cards with this back are the treasures, and the app tells us to remove any purple-faced treasures first, which I'll return to the box. The rest you then shuffle into a face-down pile. Then set these story cards, which have this back, into an unshuffled face-down pile. If you have 3 or 4 players, put this Hungry Pirates card into play. If you only have 3 players, which we'll set up for in this video, also put this Masked Pirate card nearby. Now everyone picks a pirate, taking its standee, matching colored die, treasure chest, and infamy marker to place in front of themselves. In a game with 3 players, no one can pick the Masked Pirate. Instead, put its standee by its rules card. Its other components, along with any unchosen pirates, are returned to the box. From this pad, tear off a player sheet for each person, ensuring that everyone has a unique title in this area here. Your player sheet folds into a booklet, and players will create a name for their pirate, which they'll write here. And you can use the name generator on the back of the rulebook if you'd like some help with this. On the inside page of your booklet, fill in these story blanks as indicated, which I've already done. For example, it asked for something foul, so I wrote rotten cabbage. Next, it's time to hand out the ship's roles and responsibilities, and there are 7. But if you have fewer than 7 players, that's fine. Just divide them as evenly as possible, and it means some players will have more than one role they're responsible for. The player assigned the role of the ship's scribe will collect one of these ship sheets from the pad. And then players together name the ship here, and you record the name of the scenario in this space. Anytime the game requires recording something in the ship's log, the scribe will write it down on these spaces. If you ever need more pirate or ship sheets, you can download and print new ones for free from the Plat Hat Games website, which you can access directly from the main menu right here. The player assigned the quartermaster role takes this board and each player's infamy token, putting them in random order from left to right on these spaces. In the game, when you see this symbol, that represents infamy. The first mate will track the size of the crew and their discontent, which are represented by these symbols, and the app will tell you what spaces to start these on. In this case, a discontent of 0 and a crew size of 9. The bosun keeps track of the health of the ship's hull, placing its token on the numbered space shown here within the app. Then we have the cooper, who tracks the ship's supplies, also placing its marker on the value indicated with its symbol. This is the board for the gunner, and you'll set the dials to 0 and then place the required cannons into the slots for them here at the bottom, as indicated in the app, which calls for 2 level 1 cannons, one that's loaded and one that's unloaded. The rest of the tokens you can keep nearby for possible use later. Finally, there's the lookout. They take this track and the threat tokens, along with the objective card instructed by the app under the special setup. So in this case, it says to take Decipher the Map, which you place here. You should also follow any of the other steps listed here. This second one we already completed. And this third one refers to all players, shows the treasure symbol, like we see here, and a +1, which, as it's explained here, means that all players draw one treasure card. When a player gains treasure, they place it face up in front of themselves by their chest, and the information on your treasure is not considered a secret. The final step here tells the ship's scribe to write Seeds of Doubt in the ship's log, like I've already done. In addition to the special setup rules which we just went through, there may also be some special rules when playing. And these will make more sense once you know the rest of the rules, so we'll keep going by tapping Continue. As we're told here, it's time for players to share their pirate backstories. To do this, you open your pirate sheet to this page again and read the backstory here. But anytime you come to a numbered blank space, you read the numbered word that you created here from this list earlier. So for example, I would read, "The rotten cabbage, that's what the royals called my homeland." Of course, you don't have to read with a pirate accent the whole time if you don't want to. In fact, your friends might insist that you knock it off once you get started. Speaking from personal experience. But to that I say, ignore your friends, because talking like a pirate is fun. "'Twas a place o' hard beauty, where warriors were born, living and dying by the sword and axe." Once everyone is done, whether they read like a pirate or not, tap Continue and read the introduction story to the scenario. Or, if you'd like, tap Play and let the narrator read it aloud for you. Let me give you a quick example.
"Long ago, people spoke of a land called Sunset."
Once you're finished with the introduction, you'll notice at the bottom, you're instructed to begin the first round by turning to page 19 in the location book and then hit the Done button here. These pages will present you with a picture of where your adventure is happening here on the left, as well as other details about the actions you can take over on the right. But ignore these for now. And that's the setup. In Forgotten Waters, players are the senior crew of a pirate ship that's sailing under the command of an ambitious pirate captain. You'll have to work together to ensure survival on the high seas, but each player will also have 5 events in their pirate's destiny that they're trying to fulfill just for themselves. If a player fulfills 4 of them by the time the scenario concludes, they can count themselves a winner. If they complete all 5, they've achieved a superior victory. If you get 3 or fewer, then you may or may not have survived, but you weren't a very good pirate. In this way, it's possible to have more than one winner. Of course, if players focus too much on their own objectives, the entire crew may lose to drowning, mutiny, or other threats, as we'll see. The game is played over a series of rounds, broken into 3 phases each, starting with the planning phase. This phase begins as soon as a new page is revealed. The player with the quartermaster role immediately starts the timer by tapping this symbol on the app. And it's during this 40-second countdown that players will now have the chance to read over the action titles and make their selections. The exception is if you open to a page with one of these warning sections. Read it out loud first and then start the timer. This may provide clues about actions that players should be thinking about taking during the round. Either way, once the timer begins, players take turns in order from highest infamy on the track down to the lowest, placing their pirate standee on any one of these numbered actions found on the right side page. If you have 3 players, also follow the masked pirate rules here, which says that the person highest on the infamy track also selects an action using the masked pirate standee after placing their main pirate. And this could be the same or a different action following the normal placement rules, which we'll talk about in just a moment. Each action shows a colored banner name, some icons, and a detailed description over here. But players should not read the details before making their choice. Instead, pick your action based on its banner, because if the timer runs out before everyone has made their selection, then you must raise the discontent by one, as you're reminded of here. And after doing that, players can continue picking actions as normal until everyone is finished. To adjust the discontent, just move its related marker here the required number of spaces. But be careful. If the discontent marker is ever equal to or higher than the crew token, there is a mutiny aboard the ship, and the players immediately lose, as you're reminded of right here. When placing your standee on an action, there are a few things to keep in mind. First of all, if you see a symbol like this, it means only a single player can go here during this phase. While a symbol like this means the action can hold any number of pirates. This is a required action symbol. It means the action must be chosen by exactly one person during this phase. If one or more of them have not been chosen before the last players have made their selections, those players will be forced to pick them. If you have only three or four players, the Hungry Pirates card will be in play, and this says that if a page shows the Hungry Crew action, then no one needs to select it, which is a change from what I just said. But that's because this will automatically resolve later, as we'll see. This, however, does not affect any other required action spaces that might be on the page. These will still have to be selected by one of the players. During play, you may be instructed to lock an action, and if so, you place one of these tokens on it here. If players begin a new round on this same page, then during that future planning phase, these actions will be locked and cannot be revisited by pirates. They'll have to go somewhere else. I mentioned that when choosing an action, you should go by the banner, and here you will see a series of icons. These may be symbols related to the areas of the ship that the action could affect. For example, this is the crew icon, so taking this action might increase or decrease the size of your crew. Other symbols will relate to the skills of your pirate. Your skills are listed here on the front of your pirate sheet, and each of them has an icon. So this here is the icon for the brawn skill. If you see that icon in white, it means that you might improve that skill by taking this action, and you'll have to perform a test with it, which we'll learn about later. If the skill symbol is in black, then you might improve the related skill, but you will not be performing a test with it. If you see letters, those represent the dials of the gunner's board, which may be affected by going to those actions. And a question mark, well, that just means something unknown awaits. Once everyone has placed their standees, the planning phase ends, and it's time for the action phase, where the selected actions will be resolved. So let's go back to the table and see how that works. All the actions on a page are numbered, and you start at the top action that contains pirates, resolve it, and then go to the next action down with pirates, resolve it, and so on. If there's more than one pirate on an action, each resolves their turn separately, going in order from the pirate highest on the infamy track down to the lowest. So here, blue would go first, and then yellow. If we had a situation like this, remember in a three-player game, the masked pirate is placed by the player who has the highest infamy. So the masked pirate is assumed to have the same infamy level as that player when determining the turn order, which could change during the round. Either way, you resolve your action by following the related instructions on the page here, and then when you're finished, you take back your pirate. We won't go through every action in this book, because they'll all be easy to follow once you understand some of the key concepts. So I'll pick a few examples to help explain those. This is the Hungry Crew action, and as we mentioned, with only three or four players, this card will be in play, and it says that this space always resolves. You don't put a pirate here as you normally would. Instead, the action is resolved by the lowest infamy player, which is this one. And then, as explained here, they'll pick any one of these three options. They can, for example, feed the crew, spending supplies equal to the current hunger level. Supplies are tracked with this token, and the hunger level of the crew is the number appearing through the crew token's mouth. So we could spend 5 supplies moving its token down that many steps to feed the crew. If you didn't have enough supplies, then you can't do this. But if you do feed the crew this way, the symbols here tell you that your infamy goes up by 1 and the crew's discontent goes down by 1. As we know, discontent is tracked here and infamy here. And you'll notice discontent cannot drop any further. The crew is already as happy as they can be. And this is true for all of the boards like this in the game. You can never have less than the lowest amount on the track or more than the highest amount. When your infamy goes up or down, you move your token the required number of spaces, shifting the other player markers as necessary to make room, ensuring that no spaces are left between the tokens afterwards. Going back to our hungry crew example, another option would be to ask the crew to go hungry. Understandably, their discontent goes up by 2, your swagger goes up by 1, and your infamy drops by 1. Swagger is one of your skills, and when gaining a skill, you mark off the leftmost open box in its row. A box with this X symbol is considered to be the end of its row, and you cannot fill in more of its spaces. So over the course of the game, I could at most upgrade my swagger to 5. Now let's say later I do gain another point of swagger. If the space that you're checking off contains a star, that means you now get to fill in a star of your constellation up here. To do this, fill in one of these circles that is either connected by a black line to the starting star here, or to a star you previously filled in. I'll go here, and this means that the next star I fill in can either be this one, or this one. Eventually, if you fill in a star space with an exclamation mark, take one of these Constellation Event tokens from the supply and put that in front of you, and we'll learn more about those a little bit later. Returning to the Hungry Crew action though, we see that the final option allows the crew to raid the supplies, which will increase your infamy by 4. Now our player's infamy can only go up by 2, but in that case you just move it as much as possible, which will put it in the highest infamy position. Now there is a catch. If the supplies were at 0, which they are in this case, then discontent goes up by 2. Sure, you let the pirates raid the supplies, but they found nothing when they got there. On the other hand, if you have at least one supply or more, discontent is not affected, but you lower the supplies to 0 from wherever they are. And with just that one example of one action, we've now covered gaining skills, filling in your constellation, and adjusting ship elements like supplies. Other times, the game might ask you to adjust the ship's hull, usually when taking damage or making repairs. However, if this ever reaches 0, the ship sinks and everyone loses, as you're reminded of here. So take actions to repair your ship when this starts getting low. Some actions will require you to perform a test, also known as a skill check. For example, let's say we were taking this sail action. First, it says we gain a navigation skill, marking it on our sheet, as we learned about earlier. Then it says that we perform a navigation check. A check will always involve one of your pirate skills, and you begin by rolling a single die. Then add to this value the number of boxes that you've filled in for this skill, so 1 in this case. Then check to see if you have any treasure or story cards in front of you, like this one, that might adjust your results further for that skill. And here we can see the navigation symbol and a +1. So that means our final value is 5 plus 1 plus 1 for a total of 7. Sometimes the game will tell the player to collect misfortune tokens, and if you have any of these, then when performing a check, you'll roll 2 dice instead of 1, and then you're forced to take the lower result before adding in any other bonuses. After the check, you then discard a single misfortune token. You may also have reroll tokens, and after rolling 1 or more dice for a skill check, you may discard one to reroll any one die, and you may spend these one after the other to reroll multiple times. Once you have your final number, check the information for the action and then read the related result. Here it says our infamy goes up by 1, and then we can spend any combination of supplies and or points from our hull to move the ship one space for every 2 spent. For example, I could spend 3 supplies and 1 hull point to move 2 spaces. Anytime you move the ship, pick an adjacent space you would like to go into and then draw a navigation token from the supply and put it face up there. Then set your ship standee on top of it. These may have numbers, but ignore them unless the game says otherwise. Now remember, I was moving 2 spaces, so I draw another token and perhaps I place it here, moving my ship again. However, if a space ever shows an exclamation mark symbol, the ship may not move further that round, and anything spent to move the ship is lost. In other words, if I had revealed this tile first, the ship would have stopped here, and I would not have drawn another one. I should also mention, you may never move your ship onto a space with one of these rocky waters symbols. Sometimes an action will let you scout one or more spaces. If so, you draw a navigation token unseen and place it face down onto a space adjacent to either the ship's space or a previously placed navigation token. Keeping in mind, the navigation tokens are the ones with this back. So for example, this tile here is not a navigation token. Once all of the scouting tiles have been placed, you can then flip them face up and see what they are. This may help you chart your course when you move your ship later. During the setup, we gain treasure, and you may gain more when playing, which is drawn from the treasure deck. Or you may have a chance to steal treasure, taking it from another player. Either way, treasure is always placed face up in front of you. You may never have more than four treasures at once. If you gain a fifth, discard it, or one that you already have, and then the supplies on the ship go up by one each time you're forced to do this. But you cannot choose to just discard treasures in order to gain supplies. Treasures will provide your pirate with various benefits and also boost their skills, as we saw, but some have effects that will only resolve if the player chooses to discard it when they are resolving an action during the action phase. The effect will not resolve if something else forces them to discard it. Some actions will let you bury a certain amount of treasure by discarding them, and for each one that you bury in this way, you get to fill in a star on your constellation chart. I should also mention, if the treasure deck ever runs out, just reshuffle its discard pile into a new one. Sometimes the game will tell you to draw the numbered story cards, so just go through them and take the indicated one based on its number and place that in front of you. These may provide benefits like treasure, but they may not be buried, discarded, or stolen, and there's no limit to the number of them that you can have. Also, if you're told to claim one and it isn't in the deck, then take it from whoever has it. Sometimes the game instructs players to gain or lose threat, which is represented by this symbol. The player in the lookout role then adds or removes that number of tokens from this threat track. And don't worry, as this fills up with tokens, even if it's completely filled, like you can see here, I think you can... I don't know why I thought holding this up would make more sense than just showing it to you on the table, but there we go, lesson learned. What was I saying? Right, even if this fills up with tokens, that doesn't necessarily mean that you have anything to worry about. Well, not exactly. Sometimes you'll be told to check threat. Only at that time do you check to see if the amount of threat here equals or exceeds the limit which is shown on the objective, so 2 in this case. If not, like we have here, then nothing happens. But if so, the ship's scribe marks off the next unchecked threat event on the ship's log and then reads its entry. Many times during the game, you'll be provided with a number and instructed to read that entry. When this happens, enter it into the app here and tap Yar. You'll be given some story text, which you or the narrator can read aloud, and you'll usually have some other instructions to follow at the end as well. And be careful. If you have so many threat events that this last box is checked off, then the players all lose, as you're reminded of here. Some actions in the game will instruct you to fill in the next entry in the captain's quarters or his mission. This works just like filling in the threat events. You mark off the next available space and then go to that entry in the app. Other times when playing, the game might ask which player has the highest or lowest skill, and if so, they compare just what they have marked off on their sheets, not including any bonuses they might get from treasures or other effects. In the case of a tie, whether here or any time, the tied player with the highest infamy is chosen. The exception would be if the tie is the check for the lowest of something, let's say the lowest swagger, and these two characters each had the lowest swagger with 2. In that case, infamy still breaks the tie, but it's the player with the lowest infamy that would resolve the effect. Sometimes you'll be told to gain a new cannon. If so, the gunner takes the indicated type from the stack and then places it in one of the 4 slots, either loaded or unloaded, as the game instructs. At most, a ship can have 4 cannons, but you can always discard any of these to make room for new ones. If the game tells you to upgrade a cannon, replace one you have with the higher level token, keeping it either unloaded or loaded as it had previously been. During gameplay, you may be directed to resolve your constellation events. When this happens, open to this page of your pirate sheet and return each of these tokens that you've collected back to the supply, And for each one returned this way, you check off the next unchecked Constellation events here, reading them aloud to the other players and filling in any blanks as required using the related words from here. These Constellation events will tell the story of your character's development, and they represent your objective as a player. To win the game, you want to have checked off at least 4 of these. And with that, we've now covered many of the specific types of actions you'll encounter in the game's book and app, but there are many, many more you'll discover as you play. Perhaps you'll encounter an enemy ship and have to do battle. The game will explain how those situations should be played out when they occur. One thing I want to remind you of, though, is that in a 3-player game, the person highest on the infamy track is responsible for assigning the masked pirate standee to an action. Now, this action will be resolved as normal, but if it would gain a skill or be impacted in some way, those results affect the player who put that masked pirate on the page. They would gain the skill or the tokens or have to make any required choices. Now, once all of the pirates have resolved their actions for the turn, it's time to move to the end of round phase. Here, you simply read the entry listed in the box at the end of the page. In some cases, this will give you the option of repeating the page again. For example, here I might choose to stay at the location and lose crew. It tells me to reduce the crew's value by 1, begin a new round on the same page, and also check the threat. If you repeat another round on the same page, keep any lock tokens in place, remembering that no player can assign their pirates to those actions. However, if you're told to go to a new page, remove all tokens from the old one, turn to the new page, reading any warnings that might be there, and then start the timer and begin the planning phase of the new round. The game will continue like this, but each scenario is divided into 2 parts, and the app will tell you once you've reached the end of part 1. You then have the opportunity to save your game if you'd like to just put it away and then be able to continue it later. Just follow the instructions in the app, which will tell you what to record using the backside of your ship's sheet. And then when you're ready to play again, you'll pick the same scenario and follow the instructions for resuming it. Otherwise, the game ends either when the ship's hull reaches 0, or the ship's discontent reaches or passes the crew token, or the final threat event is checked off. In each of those cases, the game ends in a loss for all of the players. However, if the game informs the players that they have completed the scenario, then any pirate who achieved 4 of their Constellation events has won. And on the back of their sheet, there's another personalized story they can read here. It's known as a good outcome. Anyone who achieved all 5 of their Constellation events gets to read the legendary outcome. And anyone with 3 or fewer Constellation events, well, they've lost, but they still get to read a story, which I'm sure you and your friends will enjoy hearing, even if it doesn't turn out to be quite so heroic an end for your pirate. Before wrapping up, I should point out that the app also has a variance button here, and if you explore this, you'll find bonus rules for a solo mode, as well as for 2-player games. But I'll leave those for you to discover on your own. But otherwise, that's how you play Forgotten Waters. If you have any questions about anything you saw here, feel free to put them in the comments below, and I'll gladly answer them as soon as I get a chance. You'll also find forums for discussion, pictures, other videos, and lots more over on the games page at Board Game Geek, which I'll put a link to in the description below. And if you found this video helpful, please consider giving it a like, subscribing, and clicking that little bell icon so you get notification anytime we post a new video. But until next time, thanks for watching.